Namaste, can you hear me?
It's so nice to see you and everyone else.
It's so good to have you here. And we are inaugurating this anniversary.
Om Sadashiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam. Om Apyayantu Mamangani Vak Pranas Chakshushrotramatho Balamindriyani Chasarvani Sarvam Brahma Upanishadam Maham Brahma Nirakuryam Mama Brahma Nirakarot Anirakaranam Astvanirakaranam Me Astu Sada Upanishatsu Dharmas Te Mai Santu Te Mai Santu Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. About 25 years ago, I used to work in the psychiatric ward. We would do the rounds in the morning wearing our white coat. We would ask the different patients questions related to reality. Questions like, what is the day today? What have you eaten for breakfast? Are you married? A lot of people would like to say no, especially the married ones. But we would cross-check for whether they were aligned to reality. They thought that we were crazy. That was a part of our job, and the technical word was to check the reality orientation. For them, we were not normal. For us, they were not normal. What we call normal or reality is something like a collective agreement. Whatever we agree to be real, most likely that is the functional reality. So, Vedanta is really the study of reality. I know it's early morning in Brazil, but I want to tell you a story. This story comes to us from the Chandogya Upanishad. It is a dialogue between a father and a son. The name of the father is Uddalaka and the name of the son is Shvetaketu. As was the system those days, Shvetaketu had gone to the Gurukulam for a period of 12 years. So he returns from the Gurukulam when he is 24. He has the bearing of a strong, proud man. So the father wants to know how his son has done. He has not been around in the house for 12 years. So Uddalaka, the father, asks the son a question. Did you ask your teacher for that knowledge, knowing which everything is as well known, hearing which everything is as well heard? What kind of a question is that? So Shvetaketu, in his arrogance, said, I don't think my teacher knew that. And you must remember that in the Sanatana Dharma culture, there is a lot of respect given to teachers and gurus. The elderly are respected. So he has grown up with that value for respect for the guru. And still he said something like, I don't think my teacher knew. Which means that if my teacher really knew this knowledge that you are talking about, then he would have definitely taught me, because I am such a brilliant student. Then after that, what happens in the dialogue? The Upanishad is silent about it. And the humility that comes with any kind of knowledge is invoked in Shweta Ketu. Very softly he asks his father, is there such a knowledge? So his father replies, Yatha saumya eka mrit pindena sarvam mrinmayam vignyatam syat vacharambhanam vikaro namadheyam mrittika eva satyam. Which means that just as knowing a lump of earth, or in other words clay, all things that are made of clay are known, so to understand that all modifications that you see, they are only name and form, and they are centered on the tongue, the vak. Then the teacher, now you know the father has transformed into the teacher because the son has transformed into a student. The father starts teaching about this knowledge. He gives the example of gold and ornaments and nail cutter and things made of that metal. Imagine more than 4,000, 5,000 years ago, nail cutter used to be there. Then in the next section, he starts with a grand declaration. Sadeva saumya idam agra asit ekam eva advitiyam brahma. Which means that all that was there in the beginning was Sat, reality. And that reality is one without a second. So all that was there is Satyam. And it is this Satyam that later on he goes on to say that Tat Satyam Tattvamasi Shweta Keto, that all that is Satyam is actually you. He will go on to repeat the teaching 9 times. For now, we need to understand what this Satyam is. Because one thing we can all agree upon, the one who is aligned with reality is a sane person. Those who are not aligned with reality, we have special names for such people. And because he talks about, so we have one pot here. Now the word Satyam doesn't really have a translation, but we can understand what it means. It is that reality which always is. Is it an object? You know, in those Superman movies, they would say, is it a bird? Is it a plane? No, it's Superman. So this Satyam, is it an object? The answer is no. Is it a relationship of authenticity, sambandha, with another person? Is it, so the answer is no. It's better to clarify, you know, because some people think Satyam, oh my sweetheart, it is Satyam. So that is relative reality, which is very important, of course. Then is Satyam a quality that sometimes it is there and sometimes it is not there? Or is an elevated action like meditation, you know, some kind of kriya, is that Satyam? So what we call Satyam is not a quality, not a group, not a relationship, and not an action. So I have few things here. This is the guru who is sitting in Petropolis. This is a student, very sincere seeker who wants to come to learn. This is a friend who cannot get along with that student. And then of course is our dear Ganapati to whom they pray. Okay, now all these forms are obviously made of clay. So whether it is the student or whether it is the teacher, there is Satyam, which is clay. The form might be different, the history might be different, but the common reality is clay. So this form, we can totally understand that there are different forms in this entire world. It could be a pot, it could be a lid, it could be anything, but it's all made of clay. So the word Satyam is over here stands for that which always is. Suppose the student gets coronavirus. The virus happens to the form but not to clay. There is another word we have to understand which is called mithya.
Yeah.
Again, mithya is not an object or a relationship or a quality. Both Satyam and Mithya are words that denote our understanding of reality. So, now either this person may survive, and likelihood is the person is young, will survive corona. Before coronavirus, the person was clay. During corona is clay, and after corona continues to be clay, even if the person dies. So the form is mithya. Why do we call it mithya? Because it cannot exist on its own. If I ask you, what do I have in my hand? Some people will say pot, some people can say clay. And the clever ones will say clay pot. So we totally get it that the pot cannot exist without the substance, and in this case it happens to be clay. The form depends on clay, and therefore it has dependent reality, and therefore we call it mithya. When I use the word form, I am talking about all the forms in the creation, from your thoughts onwards to your body mind to the elements. So while the student continues to have the body mind, the form, the reality of this form is Satyam. Trikale api tishthati iti Satyam, that which exists in all three periods of time is Satyam. That means I could have the worst kind of inferiority complex and I still continue to be clay. Because even the thinking, whatever be the thinking, that is another form in the Satyam that is me. There's one interesting thing I want to mention. It's something that happens during our funeral. So when the dead body is kept and certain rituals are conducted, generally the son will keep a pot on his shoulder with some water in it and go around the dead body a few times. And then as he's going to finish the round, the pandit, the priest, will break the pot and the water will come out. And the son is supposed to then stop and throw the pot backward. It is to indicate that this jiva, this person, is now free from prana and is ready to move forward. So imagine the pot is seen as a jiva, whether you are pot-bellied or not. So this thinking is very interesting, because when you look at the pot, there the forms keep changing. Sometimes is your mother, sometimes your son, sometimes your child, but the reality is that which is not going to change. So we call it ghata buddhi and asti buddhi, meaning as the forms keep changing, there is that form thought and there is asti buddhi, isness. So the forms will keep changing, but isness, or in this particular case clay, will always be. Then we have to also see, is clay a modification of this pot? But we totally get it that without the clay there can't be a pot, and therefore clay is, we use another word, karanam, cause, and pot is karyam, the effect. Now some people are wondering, what is wrong with this Swamini? I wanted a good life, I wanted better relations with my people, and why is she going on and on talking about pot and clay? And you know, if I say the word potty, then my 7-year-old nephew starts laughing and he's saying, what are you saying? So when the moment I say pot, he'll say, no, no, don't say potty. Pooja Swamiji would say that we have confused nouns for adjectives, and what is the reality, we totally ignore it and we make the adjective into a noun. So if our focus is on reality, then we really should be saying potty clay, liddy clay, Ganapati clay, and so on. So that which is satyam has no limitation, which is you. Any form has limitation and will continue to have limitation. And we have no problem with that, because we are focused on the reality of every form. And the beautiful thing is that the pot can recognize that while I have a limited form, I am limitless because I am pervaded by clay. In satyam, there is no limitation, no boundary, no ignorance. And therefore, dharma being the framework, different pots can interact with each other. Because where the effect is, there itself the cause is. Where mithya is, there itself satyam is. So although the talk is titled Satyam and mithya has brackets because it cannot exist on its own. Sadeva saumya idamagra asit, and therefore all forms are sacred, and that's why we are able to do namaste to all forms. Because in each and every form, although it has the status of mithya, it cannot exist without satyam. So now, sincere student has come to the guru who is sitting in Petropolis. Professor or teacher, I am willing to do all the sadhanas. You just tell me what to do. What is the sadhana by which I will become clay? I want the reality, I want satyam, I want to become satyam. The teacher is saying, but you are already satyam. No, but I want to do lot of sadhana. I have lot of energy in me. So the guru will say, okay, you go ahead and do certain things. One other student comes, he's a little older student, and he thinks that this guru is not very traditional. So he says, can you recommend some teacher in India? I want to go and study with someone who is an Indian. I want to go straight to the source. I want to know that my reality, which is clay, which is satyam. So the guru says, okay. And he gives the name of one or two teachers and says, you. So this person goes to India. Then after 3 months, the student comes back. Before going to India, the student was satyam clay, and in India the student was clay satyam. And of course, when he came back to Brazil, he continued to be clay satyam. And so he said, "Teacher, I think now I am ready to be your student. It was important for me to go to India and do the yatra pilgrimage. It was important for me to go to the temple, to the yatra, and meet other teachers, and then also reflect on what it is that you are offering me. And all along you have been pointing that I am that satyam, but I felt very rejected because you were very dismissive of me. But now I am beginning to see that even the thought of being rejected is a form which is mithya." Then one other student prays very sincerely to Ganapati, and secretly he is doing, he has taken on a discipline of Purascharana. So it's a religious discipline of repeating the mantra a certain number of times along with some meditative practices. And the student loves chanting. He loves to chant Ganapati Atharva Shirsha Upanishad, and every morning he chants. And he says, "Tvabeva Pratyaksham Tattvamasi." So he is telling that you directly are indeed that Brahman. Ganesha does not need his teaching Tattvamasi, but it is a part of the Upanishad said, revealed by Ganaka Rishihi. And the student keeps on saying, "Please Ganapati, give me moksha. Let me understand that I am the limitless and I am the basis of all forms." In India, we have one Gujarati saying which says, "Tata ne apyo, Birla ne apyo, mane nathi apyo," which means that you gave to the Tatas, you gave to the Birlas, these are big industrial houses, but you didn't give me anything. The other students in the Gurukulam, they know Sanskrit and they are getting to do very nice seva for the teacher, and they are getting some special practices. Ganesha, please look at me, I am praying so sincerely to you. And so Ganesha is now going to get irritated and he'll say, "You idiot, you are that same satyam that you think I am." But what to do? This student is very identified with the form. The student sees the form as satyam. Not able to see that this form, this body mind I have, even my most sincere desire is actually mithya. So unless the student is able to see the reality in all the forms related to oneself, the student can go from lifetime to lifetime sincerely searching but never looking at the reality of oneself. Sometimes we can get so obsessive about the sadhana that we don't look at the sadhya, what is really the goal. Then these two students, they fall in love in the Gurukulam. So now they start having a lot of fights. And they are very upset with themselves for two reasons. One is that they don't, they are trying to understand each other, but the moment they come together, they fight. And then they have heard some satyam and mithya related to Vedanta, so they try to see that, "Oh, we are all satyam." But they are not ready to see the reality. Because first they have to see that the other person is sacred, is pervaded by Bhagavan, and that in this entire Jagat of pot world, there can be all different types of people, including your boyfriend or girlfriend. The understanding of Satyam is also fullness, that which does not have any lack. And so through all the forms, they have to see that Dharma is the basis of us to interact. That all of us want acceptance, nobody wants rejection. And so I try to show care and support and strength for the other person. I don't behave like a begging person, always looking for crumbs of affection. But out of the fullness that I am pervaded by clay, Satyam, which I don't fully understand, I will focus on what I can contribute to the other person. So, to understand Satyam and Mithya, first I have to be in harmony with everyone. And therefore, the understanding of Karana Karya Sambandha, that all that is here, which is the pot world, is pervaded by Satyam, is very important. Because then the person through the sadhana would have developed a mind that is relaxed, alert, and can understand the truth. So when the teacher tells the student, na jayate mriyate va kadachit nayam bhutva bhavita vana bhuyaha, the verse in the Bhagavad Gita, that you were never born and you will never die, that the student understands. When the teacher says, ajo nitya shashvato yam puranaha na hanyate hanyamane sharire, that what you are is unborn, always present, limitless fullness, and that is your truth. So the student no longer wants to become clay, because the student recognizes that actually I am clay, I am that Satyam. But the truth may not always be available to me because I am so strongly identified with the body and mind. The body and mind is a gift, it is a blessing. So, of course, we need to identify with it to function. Suppose if somebody asks you, do you want water? You're not going to say, Atma is never thirsty, I don't want water. So you need to have that much functional identification to continue in society. But identity is not reality. And the reality obviously exists in and through all our identities, our roles, our responsibilities. It's not that my role as a lover is more real than the role as a son. So reality is in and through all the roles, and so wherever I go, whatever I do, I am that limitless Satyam. That Satyam, Tvam Asi, you are that Satyam, was the teaching of Uddalaka to Shweta Ketu. And it is the main teaching of Vedanta. There are a lot of other topics such as Karma Yoga, relationships, family, finances, dharma, and so on.
Sorry.
Yeah, but all of these different topics that are there in Vedanta are meant for us to understand this main teaching of Satyam and Mithya. Our problem is not that things are temporary or not permanent. Our problem is that what is not permanent, I want it to be permanent. A relationship, a job, the state of my finances, my health can never be permanent. Even Elon Musk struggles with it. So, what we thought was reality was actually not reality. This we understand in the light of Vedanta. And the beautiful thing is that you are the reality. That even after you have fights within the family or even with your guru, you will still be the reality Satyam. Whether you study in the Gurukulam or you are studying outside like many of y'all, you continue to be the Satyam, and my prayers that all of y'all are blessed with this knowledge. Om Tat Sat.
Thank you very much, Swami. It was very beautiful.